So in this lecture, we jump right into a new material, namely we're going to talk about feedback shift registers. So these are devices which have been around in cryptography and in general sequence designs for a long time. You're seeing here what we call a state. And you can think of this as a physical register where exactly n pieces have space. So if you have a state of size or length n, then you have n positions in there. And we typically will call them S0, S1, S2, S3. So then you have a starting state with these variables in there. And then the update function is that we push all these variables into the function. And the function takes the variable in the first input as X0, the second one as X1, X2, and so on until Xn-1, and computes a function of those. Now, when it has the function, it feeds back the result, and all the pieces in the state shift over by one. So the next state, well, this moves a lot because the function needs space, but in reality, it will be just the same side register. So we again have n spaces. The first one, the S0, has been output, and the state has been updated by shifting over by one. So the S0 is out now, and the S2 is now in the place of S1, the S1 is in the place of S0, Sn-1 is in the place of Sn-2, and the last place has been updated with a function of the previous variables. So the second state is what you see in the picture, and then at every moment we output something. So the first n+2 outputs, or the first n outputs, are just what you have in the initial states, S0, S1, S2, till Sn-1. And afterwards, we output the function that is currently in the last position of the register. And then the next one is the function compute over those. So it's now taking S1 as X0, S2 as X1, Sn-1 as Xn-2, and the function of the previous one in the last of the updates. So this is how we update those. I'll get to a concrete example in a moment. For cryptographic applications, we typically use them over F2, but the theory holds in more generality. So you couldn't have even integer sequences or rational numbers or whatever you wish. So when you want to use such a feedback shift register in a stream cipher, then you make this update function up there a function of the key. So there's an F sub K now. So it depends on what it does, depending on what Alice and Bob have agreed upon. Then you put the IV, the initialization vector, into the initial state. So your initial state will have n bits, and your IV will have n bits. And of course, well, I just showed that the first n output bits are exactly this IV. And you have to send the IV along, but you should not ever XOR your message. And well, we have learned how to encrypt with a stream cipher, that you would just XOR your message with it. And so you have to discard these first n output bits. So here's an example. I'm having a state size of length 4, so they're just S0 till S3, and I'm updating it by taking the first input plus the product of the next two plus the last one, and then plus 1. Okay, so as an example, I'm putting in the initial state 0101, and then the computation is, well, I'm taking the X0 plus X1 times X2, so plus 1 times 0, plus 1, plus 0. Sorry, plus 0, plus 1, plus 1, and that gives 0. Okay, so then I'm updating, I'm putting this 0 in the last position, and I'm outputting 0. Bottom row, I'm collecting the output. Now the next thing I'm doing, I'm computing the next update of this, so I'm taking the 1 plus 0 times 1, then it's 0, and then the plus 1 from the function. Well, okay, I'm having 1 plus 0 plus 0 plus 1, I'm over F2, so 1 plus 1 is 0. Okay, so I'm now putting in as the new rightmost position, I'm putting in the 0, everything else shifts 1 over to the left, and I'm outputting the leftmost one, so I'm outputting a 1. From now on, I'll put the calculation there when the numbers appear. So here's already the next calculation, I'm updating the state by doing the computation, by evaluating the function on the state, I'm getting a 1. So then the next thing is I will output the 0, which is in the leftmost position. I'll shift everything over, over, and then I'll put the 1 at the end. And so it continues for a long time until at some point I notice, namely here, that 0101 was a starting state. So at this point, I have seen everything already. So this is our starting state. Well, after the starting state, it will have exactly the same outputs after. There is no more different update. So that means that the output function will eventually have a period. So it will be periodic, it will repeat eventually. We can't avoid that because we're only looking at states of length 4 and the only entries are zeros and ones. So each of them has two possibilities. So we have a total of 2 to the 4, so 16 possible states. And not all of them need to appear in the same run. Well, okay, here we have an example where only 11 of them appeared, and so 5 are missing. So one of the ones which is missing is a state which is 1111. And if you want to solve some exercise, do figure out what are the updates of this sequence and what is the output when you start with 1s. Hint, you know something about the beginning of this. I will use mathematics notation for periods by putting bars on top of it. So what you see there, the 0101001100, that means it repeats after the last 0. I'm going back to the first 0, 0101001100, and so on. So it just means from then on it repeats. Now if I had started with a different starting position, if I had started with all zeros or started with 0001, all of those would have been giving me the same period, but it would have started differently. So it's just taking these numbers, like they're written on a circle, and just changing where I start from. So I've been using words already without defining them, so let me do this properly. So the definition of periods. So if you have a sequence, and I'm going to use these curly parentheses, sequence is called periodic. Well, here's an example picture if you can run around. So if you have some starting point as 0, as 1, as 2, as 3, as 4, as 7, and you see like the S7 runs into the S0, so from the S0 that's the same as S8, S1 is the same as S9, and so on. So it's just going to repeat. So if there is some length after which you see the same entries again, and well, and again, and again, and again, then we call this function periodic. In math notation, we have that the SI is the same as R plus I. So there's a non-zero extra R, which you add to the I, and you get the same values in those positions. So the period is the smallest of those numbers. So for instance, here, I'm having that the period is 8. I could also say, hey, after 16 times, I'm back at 0. After 24 times, but the smallest number, which is larger than 0, is 8, after which I'm back here. You might also encounter a situation where you have some walk up to an entry point, and afterwards you walk around in circles. So this is something which we call alternately periodic. So it's not periodic by itself, it doesn't start at 0, here it starts at S6. But again, we'll encounter something where S6 is equal to S14, S7 is equal to S15. So again, we're having an offset by 8, but only after we walk through this tail. So the tail here is called the pre-period, and the smallest I0, so that afterwards you always are in the circle. That is, so the smallest is called the pre-period, and R continues to be called the period. So both of those have a minimality assumption. So keep these pictures in mind when you're thinking of periodic functions or ultimately periodic function. Then you should think about, well, the circle or the circle with a little tail on it. Final thing I want to talk about to get more into mathematics is if you have a sequence which repeats, so it's a periodic sequence, and then I mentioned already, well, it would also hold that after 24 times or 16 times, I'm back at S0. So if you have some larger number, let's call this L, and if after L times it also repeats. So if for every I you have that SI is the same as SI plus L. Then this lambda says that the period, this R, divides L. The examples which I was giving were, of course, where 8 divides 16, where 8 divides 24. But of course, it's just one example, so let's look at the proof of this. The way that we normally establish of the proof is that we assume the contrary. So we will make a proof by contradiction, and let's assume that our L, well, it is a multiple of L, of R, and there will be some Q, some quotient, so that L is written as R times Q. But let's assume that in this case, we have some non-zero reminder here. So there is some R0, which means it's not divisible. Well, if not divisible, then this R0 is, which is larger than zero, and we're going to take the minimum remainder, so this is definitely smaller than R. And now we're just going to go through the normal steps. So we take that Si, by definition, is equal to Si plus L. And then we're going to put in here the definition of L. So L gets expanded to Q times R plus R0. So now this goes in the index, Si plus QR plus R0. Then we notice, well, in the denominator we just have integers, so we can move things around. We can put parentheses every which way. And R was a period. So after R times, we're the same spot. So any multiple of R, we're also at the same spot. So we can just ignore any multiple of R in the index. And so what we have there is that as Q times R, well, that is the same as, we can forget about it, so it's the same as zero, plus I plus R0. So we now have proven that as I is the same as I plus R0. So here we're using the definition of the period. That's kind of curious. So we've now just shown that for any I, we have that Si is equal to Si plus R0. But that's actually a definition of period or periodic function. And we have said that R is the smallest for which this holds for all I. But we've just shown that this also holds for R0. And by our assumption, R0 is strictly between 0 and R. So this would contradict, or this does contradict, the minimality of the period. And so that means our assumption from before was wrong. The only assumption we put in there is that R0 is larger than 0. So R0 must be 0 itself, and that means that R divides L. So we have now seen the definition of feedback shift registers and a long example of it. And then with this example, we talked about the definition of period, about ultimately periodic functions and the pre-period. And we proved a very important lemma, namely that if you see something which repeats after a certain number, then the period is a divisor of this number. All right, that's it for now. Thank you for your attention.